Testing. Welcome, welcome to translations of anime into German. My name is Gunther. I'm so very glad that so many people are so interested in this topic. Yes. Actually, my name is Sonny Strait. I am a voice actor and comic book artist. Voice acting, comics! Mostly known for in comics as an artist on ElfQuest. I drew that series back in 2001. And then I'm currently coloring ElfQuest at Dark Horse Comics. And I also worked at Tokyo Pop on my own series, We Shadows. Now let's talk about stuff people really want to hear about. I am a voice actor as well, known for Krillin and Dragon Ball Z. Usopp on One Piece. Currently, we just finished. Oh, sad. Koro Sensei from Assassination Classroom. Miss him already. And I believe this is just a general Q&A, right? So if you guys have Qs, I'll provide the A's. If no one stands up here to ask a question, like this brave man is just dying to do it, then what I do in my class is I start with you. You have to ask a question. You have to ask a question. And this lovely girl in the belly dancing outfit has to ask a question and do a dance. So, you'll do the dance? Okay, let's just see that. I'm here for the belly dancing. That's what I want on a t-shirt. Otakon, I'm here for the belly dancing. But any question is fine, and I guess we'll start with you. Hi.
Hi.
Just two quick questions.
Yeah, if you guys want to, just line up.
That's cool.
Two quick questions. What's the first one?
First one is, what are you collapsed on Dragon Ball Z Abridged?
Woo!
What is that?
Thank you.
Abridged?
Yes.
Is that a new one we're doing? I'm just kidding. I think the Krillin own count is brilliant. Funniest thing I've ever heard. Although I do think that those boys should go further. Oh. If anything is open for parody, it's Dragon Ball Z. Always said if I was doing a parody of Dragon Ball Z, the first episode you'd see nothing but bathroom stalls and the legs of the Dragon Ball Z fighters underneath, and you'd hear, "Yah!"
And Super Saiyan.
Yeah, exactly. You'd see like somebody's hair pop up at the top. Yellow hair. Yeah.
Oh,
that's Goku's personal stall, you can tell. Yeah. And that would just be episode one. We'll just start there and start the humiliation.
Deal with it.
What's your second question?
Can I get a picture of you after the panel?
Absolutely not. I don't take pictures with. No, sure.
Excuse me, can I? So, first of all, I have to say, big fan, okay? We wanted to meet you for, like, so long.
Well, I'm glad we finally met. What's your name?
My name's Aaron.
Hi, Aaron. I'm Sonny.
So, yeah, I've been watching DBZ since I was, like, a kid. So, I grew up watching the original DBZ, the original dubbed originally, so the announcer.
I bet somebody in this room wasn't even born when I started doing Dragon Ball Z.
So,
who is younger than 20? Or younger than 18? If you're younger than 18, I gotta see an ID. long time.
Yeah.
With you guys remember when I was Toonami Tom? I mean, I was Toonami Tom again last year. They brought the two Toms together and head-to-head fight, which was really cool. Yeah, but yeah, it was a long time ago. It was cool.
So wait,
we raised you bitches.
The whole bathroom scene that you were just saying about, you can't forget the DBZ announcer. Like, you can have him at the end do the whole year.
Next time on Dragon Ball.
Yeah, exactly.
Next time on Dragon Ball Z, there's no toilet paper.
Oh my God. Krillin's just sitting in a stall by himself. Goku, where are you? Come on, Goku, can you spare a square?
No, was, like when you first started, like when you first started working on Dragon Ball Z, like what was it like for you? Because like you were like one of the original like couple people who actually started.
That was the only show we had.
Yeah, it's true. Besides, they give you a coffee show later on, though.
Yeah, that came like 2 years in, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
it was. I didn't expect it to be a career. Because there was nothing like it around. And I always wanted to be a cartoon voice actor, but I lived in Dallas. I didn't plan on living in LA or New York, so I figured I would never do that. I went to college to be a theater professor, and I was all involved in theater. Then Funimation had open auditions for Dragon Ball Z, and I thought, I'll give it a shot. And then I landed the part of Krillin, right? And it was so cool. Like, I'm doing cartoons. But you know, Krillin dies a lot. Still a part-time job to me. I didn't take it seriously.
Yeah, but like you got to work with awesome people. I mean, Sean Schimmel and like all the whole crew. You know.
Yeah, and Chris Sabat, Mike McFarlane, Tiffany Vollmer, and Stephanie Nadolny.
Yes.
Yeah, that was an awesome time, and it was cool because we were kind of in the cutting edge of a new art form that was really starting to take hold. I mean, anime had been around since I was a kid, but it really started getting popular. Dragon Ball Z at one point was the highest rated animated TV show in American history.
Wow.
I mean, I used to sit in front of the TV watching Yuzi as a kid, and I remember every time Dragon Ball Z would come on, I would sit there, and whenever the announcer came on, I would sit there and be doing that the whole year. Next time, on Dragon Ball Z!
Well, it's so cool too, because we didn't know what that meant. We just thought, wow, a lot of people are watching. And then we went to Comic-Con for our first convention, and the lines went for hours.
It was over 9,000
people. When the
DBZ movies came out, I was in the theaters when they came out. Both times, I sat next to some really awesome fans and one of the AMCs. The first movie, when it ended, there was no announcer. So what I did is I was in the back of the theater, and from the back of the theater, I was like, next time on Dragon Ball Z! And the crowd went nuts. Like,
I'll tell you my most awesome moment in a theater. I was watching an X-Men movie, and they had an ad for Toonami before the movie. And at the end of the ad, there was Toonami Tom, my Toonami Tom, and he says, Carpe Diem, baby. And I went, whoa! I gotta cut you off. You asked way too many questions.
No.
I'm gonna hit him if he asks another question. Yes.
Alright, had you watched anime much before you started voicing stuff for Dragon Ball Z?
Well, I was a huge fan of, this is how old I am, Speed Racer. We didn't know it was anime. I don't think the word was even around at that time for us. It was just a cool cartoon that we loved. And I met Peter Fernandez, the voice of Speed Racer, like a year before he died. And when I was a kid, I loved that show so much. They didn't make toys of the Mach 5 and the cars on the show, but I took a white Corvette and I painted it to look like the Mach 5. And I went around just playing with this thing all day. Well, cut to many hundreds of years later, and I'm a voice actor. And I'm signing next to Peter Fernandez. And he has a table full of these Mach 5 Hot Wheels, you know, specifically designed and selling for $50. And I said, Peter, you save me one of those, I'm gonna buy it, you know. And he goes, oh, dude, he just signed it. He goes, here you go, sign it. And I went, oh. And he's just like this. Sign. Yeah, but yes, I did. I probably, let's see, what was the one I watched? Project Echo is one I'd seen, Akira, before I was on Dragon Ball Z. And I also saw Dragon Ball before I was on Dragon Ball Z. And I saw it in the original Japanese. It just looked like a cool cartoon, and I watched it. And then I get cast, and I see a poster of Goku riding a cloud at Funimation. And I said, oh, I've seen that show, what is that? And they said, that's the show you just got cast on, dude. And I went, oh, I've seen it, cool! So, I was. This SMS, what would you like to ask? And there you are, we found it.
Well, first off.
You are Waldo. This is not some obscure anime character. But it looks suspiciously like Waldo. Okay, cool.
No, I'm Waldo.
Okay.
First off, you're awesome. I'm a big fan.
Thank you, you're awesome.
Thank you. And,
I only have one question because I couldn't think of anything else. So, is peanut butter sweet or savory?
Is peanut butter
sweet or savory?
Oh,
sweet or savory?
Yeah.
I'm gonna have to go sweet.
Yeah.
And the reason why is because if I need a sugar fix and I don't want to get a big giant candy bar or something, I will go to a peanut butter sandwich.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it is savory. It is, you're right. But it's more sweet than savory. So.
Thank you.
Thank you. How much are you doing?
I'm good. And, cool. I just wanted to ask you, Usopp is one of my besides him, be my all-time favorite Straw Hat pirate because...
Mine too.
Even though he's like a huge liar, but he just has a lot of heart. And I just wanted to ask you, when the episode when Usopp and Luffy sadly fight for the Mary, how did you feel actually recording during that fight?
I was over.
It tore me apart.
That horrifying, terrible scene where they fight and it's just emotional and everything, I was overjoyed. As an actor, to be able to sink your teeth into something that emotional, and I've said this about Usopp many times, I thought that Usopp was just going to be comic relief, but he has so many emotional story arcs that I really get to sink my teeth into as an actor. There's a scene, you remember when he gets all the money stolen from him? And he's crying, he's humiliated and angry and embarrassed, and it's all these emotions at once. While I was recording that, this is the first time it ever happened to me, tears actually streamed down my face as I'm recording. I was with him in that moment, and I was just like, you're my favorite character. Usopp is the hardest character for me to do vocally. Krillin talks like this, but Usopp talks like that with a hitch in his voice? That hurts. But I love Usopp. Any chance I get to play Usopp, I just save a moment. And I mean, he has his own superhero theme song that he sings. All the wind carries my name.
Yeah!
So that, yes.
Thank you.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Brady. Hey Brady, how are you?
Very good.
Good.
I just wanted to say I love watching Assassination Classroom and I cannot for the life of me picture anybody else voicing Koro Sensei.
Thank you. I didn't even have to audition for that one. Joel McDonald cast it, he goes, that's Sonny. It was the easiest part I ever got. I love it. I love playing that.
So I wanted to know what parts of the character and really just the show in general that you just really love playing, because I have to think that has to be one of the best roles for an actor to play, someone like Koro Sensei.
Well, as I mentioned earlier, I never planned on being a voice actor. I thought I was going to be a theater professor. I thought I was going to teach. That's what I wanted to do. And I loved acting and loved everything about acting, so I thought this would be a great passion. And then I started drawing comics while I was in college and I got a story published. And I said, oh, forget college. I dropped right out of college and forgot all about it. And then it wasn't until years later that I got on Dragon Ball Z and found a whole new career. But I still miss teaching. And I've done teaching, throughout the years. And I started actually my own voice acting workshop. And the first class, the week of the first class was the week we first started recording Koro Sensei as well. And I was like, oh, this is cool, this is meant to be. And it was weird too, because a lot of times, similar ideas that I was expressing in class, that I was really teaching in class, would be expressed in this, because, teaching is teaching. And so it just really felt like a part that was me, And never did the director have to explain to me why I was saying something, because I got it right away. And then a lot of times your characters are like, well, what's going on here? I don't quite get it. With him, I got it. Yeah. That answer your question?
Yeah, thank you.
Cool. Hi.
Hi. First off, I am unspeakably sorry that I missed my chance to get your autograph earlier, with Caitlin.
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Well, I will never be back. Did you have something you wanted signed?
Well,
now that you mentioned it, I don't have any markers.
It was just having to sign work on program, honestly. It was nothing major. But anyway, I just wanted to ask out of the many many roles that you've had over the years. I know that there are others besides the ones that you've mentioned.
Yeah.
So I was
Played Maple on what is it called? Show by Rock. Have you seen that one yet?
No. Oh, sorry.
What else? I played tons. I played Alan and Escaflowne. Are you guys gonna see the showing of that tomorrow? Yeah. But anyway, go ahead.
I was just wondering, out of all those roles, you know, which is the one, and take it from, I hate questions like these, getting them personally. I'm not one of those guys, you know, conditioned out, but I can't take it, you know? So,
which one am I most ashamed of?
No, okay, we could make that a question, but
I just knew the answer to that one.
But I was gonna ask, which one have you had the absolute most fun with?
Okay, I'll start with the one I'm most ashamed of.
Okay.
I was walking in the hallways of Funimation, and Chris Bevins, the director up there, said, "Hey, Sonny, you got a minute? I got a character." And I said, "Sure." So I popped it in, and it was a character who was buying soiled panties from a soiled panty store. And I'm like, "Do those exist?" And he goes, "Yeah, they're actually pretty common in Japan." I was like,
"Are you kidding me?
What do you do with soiled panties? Make soup? I don't know what you're doing." So, the weird thing was, is that I played this skeevy perv, right? And then the thing I'm most ashamed of about it is I wasn't ashamed. I was just like, "Oh, $50 is $50.
Who was this?
I can't even remember. I didn't even ask what show it was. I didn't want to know.
Okay, fair enough.
But okay, what's the most fun to do? Oh god, I guess Corvus Insect is the most fun. I have a blast in Corvus Insect. That being said, Mace uses a blast. Lupin the Third is also an amazing character. Krillin, but still, Koro is just—it's just so easy. You know, it just feels so—it just flows. So yeah. Did that answer your question?
Well, yeah. And you know, I forgot what I was gonna say.
Get the end of the line.
All right. So, thanks.
You're welcome. Hi.
Well, hey there, Krillin!
Hey, is that Krillin?
Yeah, it's Krillin. You gotta be higher, man. It's up here.
Yeah, I'm still
hey, a little... You know,
you're close.
I'm post-pubescent.
Can you imagine just going through puberty during that?
Honey, honey!
Oh! Finally! Now I'm Barnock.
So,
that's how I get to Bardock, actually. I start with Krillin, work my way to Bardock.
So, I was actually wondering, how long did it take you to nail the Krillin voice?
Well, actually, the original cast, I don't know if you guys remember, this is 20 years ago, was done in by Ocean Group in Canada. And the original Krillin, his voice sounded like this.
Hey, guys, wait up, it's me, Krillin!
And I got the part because I could mock him the best, right? And with the first week of recording, director back then was named a guy named Barry Watson. He was a good old boy from Texas. And he said, "You know, that sounds just like Terry Clawson, but I can't stand that voice." Like, "Oh no, is this the first part I ever got? I thought he was gonna fire me." And I said, "Dude, I can do other voices." He goes, "Oh, I know, I remember from the audition. That's why we cast you. So I thought maybe you could do something else." I'm like, "What do you want?" He goes, "Well, Krillin's a midget. But he's also the world's strongest human being." And I went, "Oh, so like a tough midget." "Yeah." And I said, "What about like Popeye on helium?" And he said, "What would that sound like?" And I went,
"I don't know, something like this. Come on, guys, let's go."
"Yeah, use that." That's how I came to it.
Two more questions.
Okay.
Let me switch it up. So,
is that Krillin too?
No,
it's Vegeta.
Yeah, it's actually Vegeta from TFS.
Very cool.
God damn it now.
It is me, Vegeta. Okay.
How about
And thank you all for coming to the Dragon Ball Z auditions.
I'm doing Saturday nights at the local bar.
This is the beat right here. Okay, so.
So actually, you know, when you were working with Chris Ayers, Sean Chamel, Chris Sabat, I remember back in the Resurrection F panel that Chris Sabat actually said after he was done voicing Vegeta or Piccolo, he came out and he was like, and he was pissed off, and he was, and everybody in the studio was like, don't fuck with him. He just got done recording.
Really?
Yeah. And that was just from what Chris said personally, and Sean was like,
yeah.
And I was wondering, you know, how many fun experiences, like, do they outshadow the bad experiences in the booth?
I don't have any bad experiences in the booth, really. Well, there was one time I was directing Sean Schimmel, and Sean had gas. He was talking about it the whole day, and he's like, oh, you do not want to come in here. Like, keep that door closed! There's an old booth that had like a little vent in the back, and at one point he was like a dog trying to sniff for air. And he just stunk up that booth all day. And then, but to his credit, when he was done, he shut the door really quickly and left. Well, I went on break, I got some coffee, and then Laura Bailey was coming into the room. Figured out already what happened. She was in the booth, she went in there quickly, shut the door, and I said, okay, Laura, this character I need you to play is a, and I hear, and I'm like, are you okay? Because I've forgotten. And she goes, what is that smell?
Oh, abort, get out!
And she goes, oh my god, what was that? And I was like,
Sean
had gas. She started crying. I told Sean about that the next day, and Sean said, yes. This is a lesson, kids. Goku is an evil bastard. But even that is still kind of fun. So I really believe I've stumbled onto a job that is always fun. I never go, oh man, I'm gonna go work today.
Because it's more rewarding than anything.
Always rewarding, yes.
My final question is, do you think at the end of the panel, you could sign my first ever copy of Dragon Ball Z? It was from the original.
If you find me a marker, I'll tell you what, I'll sign you guys, I'll give you guys like the last 10, 15 minutes and I'll sign anything you brought just for coming to my panel. How's that?
From one kill to another, thank you so much. Tommy, help me up, bitch.
What's your question?
Okay, yeah. So you have characters like Krillin for Mace Games.
No, I don't have that one.
How does it feel voicing so many characters that have died?
That's in my costume. They have to die. Characters that should die, like, what?
Sean
Bean. No, I mean, like on Sunday.
That's true. Actually, every character I play dies, except for the one that should die, who never dies, and that's Usopp. Even Koro Sensei dies. Oh, man. But yeah.
Spoilers!
What?
Spoilers.
Oh, right. Well, it's already out. Why haven't you watched it yet? Plus, he has to die, anyways. That's the setup of the show.
Hi, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
Good night. I just have a quick question because I know in voice acting it's more acting than voice. I mean, you want to have that range. Range is always nice, but man, if you can act, you know.
Yeah, but it is also being able to match those mouth flaps on the screen.
Oh, sure, absolutely.
It is a rhythmic talent that some people have and some people don't. Because I did a lot of theater before I was a voice actor, and so I started bringing in actors I knew who were brilliant who could not match the flaps. They couldn't let go. A lot of actors have in their head the way something should sound, and this is it. It's got to sound like this, because it's the believable read for me. You don't have that luxury when you're doing anime, because the flaps dictate what you say and how you say it. And I always say it's like puppeteering, except you're the puppet, and the screen is the puppeteer, and you got to let yourself go. And once you're in that mode, where you get that rhythm down and you just let yourself go and flow, then it becomes a part of how do I show the motivation of this character? You know, then that's where the acting comes in. So yeah, it's a weird kind of acting.
Right. Well, the question I had was really in terms of acting, in your experience, what is one of the like most useful things that you've learned over time and that you've seen when you put yourself to use and really improve your acting and really take it to where it needs to be and help it grow?
There's a book called, it's by Boleslavsky, called Acting the First Six Lessons. It is a great book, but really you only need it for one page. And that one page talks about when you have to do a line at a time, like when you're doing a movie or doing anime or whatever, you can only do one line at a time. When you're doing theater, you got a chance to really explore this character, right? Physically and everything, right? But when you're doing a movie or doing what we do, you got usually just do one line. So how do you put yourself in that moment for just that one line? And the best way to do that is to give yourself an action verb for motivation. One word. Like if you say, I'm going to the store, right? You can give the action verb kill. I'm going to the store! And it changes the read just by the motivation. Love, I'm going to the store. And you're coming with me. But you see what I'm saying? It's like, it's a really quick trick to getting it. And sometimes I still do this. If I'm just not feeling it, I'm like, okay, what is the action verb here? And then I go, okay, that's what it's trying to do. And if you can distill it to just that, your motivation will be pure.
Great, thank you so much.
You're welcome. Hi.
And I actually have three questions all involving Usopp.
Usopp, okay.
Now, one of them I actually asked Ethan to actually play Usopp. That's one question. But the first one is, I would like how one of the people here said about like the situation in Water 7 with, you know, losing money, getting a fight. Out of all the other Usopp dramatic moments, which one also stuck out for you?
My favorite was, I don't know if you call this dramatic, but was singing the Sniper King song. Oh my god, that was wonderful.
And
but also, what was the one where Usopp, he just comes back, he takes off the Sniper King mask, and he's looking down at Usopp, I mean, he's looking down at Luffy, getting his butt kicked. And he's screaming at him, you know, from top of the mountain.
Yeah, like after Lucci really gave Luffy a big
one. That was a pretty cool, fun moment, yeah.
And the second one, have you actually seen the 4Kids version of Usopp?
I haven't. I haven't seen their version.
No.
You're lucky. You're really lucky.
Is it good?
Please!
So much!
I do know that the Japanese company was not pleased with it. And I also, this because of that, it was really good for us. Not just because we got the show, but because the first time in my history of 20 years of doing this, I was actually cast by the creator of the series.
Oda himself?
Oda himself and his crew. That's better. They really wanted a hand in it because they did not like the direction 4Kids went. So they said, we want a hand in who you cast. And so they told Funimation to pick 4 or 5 of the best actors for each read, for each character. They sent the recordings to Japan, and Oda and his crew decided who was going to play what. And the best thing about that is that Oda has said, in his mind, they speak English. The characters speak English. So in essence, we are the Japanese cast. We are exactly what Oda says that Oda wants. And that's the one character I say, if you don't like the way I do it, I don't care. Because I can't get any better than what the creator hears in his head.
And finally, as you ask yourself, out of all the Dufu powers have you seen in your time with the Straw Hats, which one you wish you could have?
Which power?
Yeah, of all the dull fruit users that you've seen over the
journey. It would be cool to have Luffy's power, I think.
Can you actually say
that? Because I was always a fan of like Fantastic Four and Mr. Fantastic being able to stretch like that would be really cool.
You just don't want to get off the toilet if you have run out of toilet paper.
That's true. It all comes back to the toilet. It's my fault because I started the panel out. I first though, my mind went to a really horrible place, and I thought, is he using his appendages for wiping purposes? But you meant he could go grab the toilet paper.
Exactly.
You've been there. I can tell you're speaking for pain.
Thanks.
Thank you. Hi.
Hello, I'm Jeff.
Good. Hi, Jeff.
So, I have two questions, and my first question is that has anybody tried to prank your lines while you were recording in the booth?
What we like to do, we drop bombs for the other actors. Yes, that happens all the time. Oh, my friend Kristen McGuire plays Hanau from Assassination Classroom, one of the students. And you know, there's a scene. Sorry, he dies. But he decides to call Ro, you know, and he calls each character by their name, you know, and when it came to hers, I just said, Kristen O'Brien. So she's getting already emotional to say this, right? And she's just ready to cry this. And so she hears, Kristen McGuire. Damn it, Sonny! But the king, I think, of dropping bombs is a guy named Clifford Chapin. I mean, if you guys see all this stuff. He always drops tons of bombs. He drops so many bombs, I find myself writing bombs for him. Yeah! Here, sing this too. Yeah. That answer your question?
Yes. My last question is, if you're acrylic voice, can you say solar flare?
Yeah!
Solar flare!
Hi.
Hi,
I'm Sean.
Hey, Sean.
I was wondering, what out of all the characters you voice, which one did you put more, like, could you see more of yourself in one of the characters than the other ones?
Weirdly, it's Koro Sensei, this octopus guy. I really relate to him a lot. I also relate to Maze Hughes a lot. Well, you remember the line in the original series when he says, sorry, but I have a wife and daughter to go home to.
Yes!
Well, that was one of our lines in the audition, right? And after the audition, Colleen Klinkenbeard, who was directing, said, hey, Sonny, we're going out for drinks after auditions. You want to come? And I said, sorry, but I have a wife and daughter. And I left, and she told me later that when, as I was leaving, she thought, oh, crap, he is Hughes. So, I was typecast immediately for that. It's probably the easiest decision she made.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hi.
How's it going? Huge fan.
Oh, thanks, man.
And just one question. Somebody already asked, what's it like to have so many characters who die? But then, especially with Krillin, what's it like to have characters who die and then come back again?
Well, I'll tell you. And then die. Krillin was my first and only character. And then Chris Sabat called me up and he goes, man, I hate to tell you this, but your character dies. I was like, no! And he goes, yeah, he was a fun character, I'm sorry, man. And I was like, so he died, and we thought that was the end. Oh, and back then, this was before YouTube, you know, before the internet was half as cool as it is now, we didn't know. We just thought he was dead.
That's the crazy thing, because then you get a call like, yeah, you're still coming to work Monday, right?
Well, that's what he said. He called me like a month later and said, oh, sorry, you're actually back. You're what? He said, well, you know the Dragon Balls, well, they wish him back, and he comes back to life. And I was like, okay. And then he died again. I think he died four times total, from the original series to GT, but we don't count GT, but anyway. But that's quite a bit of dying. But then Maze Hughes, I mean, when he died, I was like, oh man, I'll never get to do that character again. It was so cool, right?
Oh, yes.
And then Mike McFarlane, another director, called me up and said, hey, we need to do some more Hughes. And I went, zombie Hughes? They wished it back. Though it was in me disguised as Hughes, right? And so I got to be an evil Hughes. But then I thought, that's the end, right? Then we did a movie, and we said, oh, good, you get to be Hughes again. And I went, oh, cool, I can't wait to go on about my wife and daughter. And he goes, you don't really have a wife or a daughter. And he's kind of a Nazi. When I say kind of, he actually is a Nazi. I was like, oh, okay, so. But then I thought, that's the end. No. And then Brotherhood came out. Yeah. He had this grand bloody death, which was great. And then I thought, that's it. It's time to mourn him. He's not gonna... Then we started getting these OVAs. So I'm like, all right, forget it. I am not mourning Hughes. I'll probably be doing him next year. Who knows? But it's just better to say he's going to come back someday.
Thank you.
Krillin and Hughes come back way more than any religious figure. Hey, you did go back to the end of the line. Okay, we're out of time. No, I'm sorry. What's your question?
Are you signing on Sunday because I
think we have a sign yet.
Elementary?
Yeah.
I'll find out a second.
Okay, cool.
Thank you.
You waited in line for that?
Yes, I did actually.
Okay, cool. That's nice.
can I just get a quick photo with you?
Yeah, come up here. Come on stage. We'll do a selfie.
Yes!
I was close.
Hello. I just wanted to ask you if you had any regrets about giving up your role as the voice for Tom.
No. And I understand why they had to do it. It was a logistics thing. We were, at the time, again, back in the days when the internet was not as cool as it is now, we could have Skyped it today, but I was in Dallas, they were in Atlantis. They were in a land beneath the ocean. Can you imagine how hard it is to get service down there? So, they were in Atlanta, I'm in Dallas, and they did what was called a digital patch, which was very difficult to set up back then. It took over an hour to set it up. And it worked fine for a while, but the studio in Dallas that I was working with started getting lazy, and they waited until I showed up instead of what they were doing, which was set up an hour before I got there. So I'm sitting there waiting, the director is waiting on the phone, and we're waiting for an hour for them to set this up. So really, that studio cost me a great gig. So they had to go with somebody else in another studio, and then with Steve Bloom, because he was in LA, and they had the system set up really well there, because they were used to doing that. So that's why I lost that gig. Cool thing is, Steve Bloom, the first time I heard him read, I thought it was me. And I was like, that's not me. And I was like, that's an impression of the way I talk. That is bizarre. Because Toonami Tom is just basically me, you know? So that was kind of cool. But yeah, it was kind of sad to lose the gig, mainly because it paid $400 down.
That can't be ours.
Back in 2000, that was a lot. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Alright. First, I don't know if I mentioned this earlier, but hi, I'm Dale. Huge fan of...
Is that Dale?
Dale.
Nice to meet you.
Huge fan of all your voice acting work, including a lot of minor roles that I've just seen you doing from reading the credits. But, and the person who was cosplaying as Waldo earlier kind of made me think of this. And answer this in the voice of one of your characters.
Okay.
What would you do for a Klondike bar?
I would marry a sophisticated blow-up doll. For a Klondike bar. Hey, it's okay, she's 18.
That is the first time anyone's ever asked that question in 20 years of doing this. And I told my wife one day, I'm just going to have a bunch of cards that'll have everyone's questions on them since I'm asked them all the time. And if you can ask a question that's not in here in this deck, I'll give you a prize or something. I would have had to give you a prize because no one's ever asked me that. Ask your question.
Hi, I'm that one.
Careful, he's the hugger.
Back there is Regina. She's a prison bitch.
Anyway, is this an after-hours panel?
I was wondering, since you have a unique perspective, could you compare and contrast Hughes in the original Full Metal and Hughes in Brotherhood?
He dies a lot faster in Brotherhood. Well, the death scene actually takes longer, but he dies like episode 8 or something, whereas 25 in the first one. There's a major difference is they didn't get a chance. I didn't get a chance to sink my teeth into the character, but it's also, I think he's a bit goofier in Brotherhood in general, you know, than he is in the original series. He has some pretty badass moments in the original series that I just mentioned, Brotherhood. Thank you.
Hi,
I'm Andrew.
Andrew.
And, I just want to say, ever since I was a little kid, I've always been short and people picked on me, so I always...
Me too!
Exactly! So
how tall are you?
5'6".
That's what... Oh, I'm 5'6 and a half.
You're really gonna tell me half inches here?
But I'm wearing flats, so... Yeah, you guys can lift there.
Yeah. Anyway, but I just want to say, Krillin was always like an idol. Even though he got killed, I was just like, at least he put up the fight against aliens, and he is 100% human. So I just want to say...
Here's what I would say about Krillin. Krillin, courage is not being without fear. Courage is being afraid and doing what you've got to do anyway. And Krillin will go in knowing he's going to be turned into chocolate and die. Just to buy his friends and family a couple of seconds to get indoors. That's courage. Anybody who says Krillin's a coward doesn't know what courage is. And anyone who doesn't have faith in short people, well, they're just tall idiots.
Thank you. I do have just one more question. Do you play Pokemon Go, and if so, what team are you on?
No, I do not.
Come on! There's
everyone in Funimation's playing except me. Maybe because I have a job to do. I remember I was walking in the hallway just yesterday, and there's a girl standing like this in the middle of the hall. And I went, is she having a stroke? She's kind of like rocking a little bit like this. And I was like, oh my god, what's going on? And I turned up. Oh, she's trying to find a Pokemon in the Funimation. There are Pokemons in Funimation.
There's a gym, apparently, I think, in one of the recording studios.
Yeah?
Apparently. Yeah.
That's awesome.
That helps.
I always tell people my studio, because studio does some weird things, like the screens will just go off and come back on. So I've made up this story that it's haunted by a voice actor who died here 5 years ago. We have a lot of new actors, they believe me. Yeah.
Sorry, I'll stop after this one, but I gotta ask. Do you
think
I can get a selfie with you too?
Yeah, come on up.
Thank you, man.
And while you're getting that prepared, come on up. What's your name?
Hi, my name is Serge.
What, Serge?
Yes.
Serge, what's your question?
What
don't mind us, just a couple of short guys. Well, Serge, what was the question?
What is the one line you never expected to say as a voice actor?
Don't fall on Teddy! Excuse the full monologamist. You don't get to say that often. Except for my anniversary, I say, please fall on Teddy. But it's something completely different. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Hi.
Hi, my name's Chris.
Hey, Chris. What's up? Have I seen you at a con before?
Actually, no. You just met me today.
Oh, that was... Okay, that was all the way back to this morning.
I actually was in the afternoon getting our autograph.
Yeah. How are you?
Okay.
How you been?
Pretty good. Okay, so here's my question. Have you ever done impressions before of an actor?
Yeah, I've done some, yeah. When I played Lupin, we did like a series of movies from Lupin the Third, and I directed all but one of them. I think we did 10. And almost every episode, he would do an impression of another character in disguise. He would disguise as that character, and he would do their voice. So for me, that meant I got to mock a Funimation actor, which was a blast. But yeah, I've done an impression. Here's my impression of Sean Chimmel's Goku. No!
Okay,
one last question. Can't let you idiot!
One last question. Can you say in your best impression of Gandalf saying, you shall not pass?
You shall not pass!
Thank you.
Hi, I'm a big fan, and I had a question I asked you about. First
thing
about Android 18 and the arc of self, how much
actually
your personal thoughts, and how
did
the process
of
looking
at
through
to do what with her?
To, like,
I mean, what?
To, like,
my process with
your experience.
About the experience of the cell socket?
Yeah, the relationship with Android 18.
Oh, yeah, I love that. As a matter of fact, I loved his relationship with her from the beginning, from when he had a crush on her. Do you remember when he had the device? Given by Bulma, they could shut down the androids.
Yeah,
Yeah, and he's got this existential angst, you know. Well, in the original series, and I think also in the one we just did with Kai, right?
Yeah.
It's all mental. It's all mental lines, right? And up to that point, I never had a monologue of stuff for Krillin to say that was all in his head. So I got to act it any way I wanted. It didn't have to match the flaps. It was just me feeling for this character, and I really connected with him. I go, oh, I get it. He's a sucker. He's a sucker for love, and he's falling hard. The thing is, though, their relationship is pretty twisted. First of all, that she is an android, or a cyborg, really, right? Because she obviously have kids. But also, the kid they have, what's her name? What was Krillin's girlfriend's name? That's how you know she's a robot. No human woman would put up with that.
Hey, I got an idea. Let's name our first child after my first girlfriend.
Mary.
That'd be awesome, right?
Yeah, you can get away with that. I've been married a long time. I know. That would never happen. That answer your question?
Yes.
Cool. Hi.
Hi. Huge fan, by the way. Do you have any plans for Krillin for Dragon Ball Super?
Do I have any plans for him?
Yeah.
My only plan is that I hope I get to do it.
Alright, second question. Do you love Deadpool?
Do I love Deadpool?
Yeah.
I do. I haven't seen the movie yet.
I don't want to spoil it, but it has a lot of funny jokes in it.
Yeah, that's not spoiling. It looks good.
That's thank
pretty
you.
Much part of the course, wouldn't you say?
Have you ever thought of...
What?
Have you ever thought of cosplaying as someone you played as, like Krillin?
No, I've never really cosplayed anything I've done. Although I have considered it, somebody had offered to make me a Mace Hughes uniform, and that's... If they had actually gone through with it, I would have worn it. Closest I came to was at a convention, somebody was dressed as Mace Hughes, who introduced me for opening ceremonies, and I said, can I borrow your jacket? And he said, yeah. So I came out in the jacket, and I got a big applause. But that's the closest I've done cosplay. Do you like cosplay?
Yeah.
Cool. What do you usually like to do? What's your favorite character to cosplay?
I'm
Hachi Miku. Oh, nice. But you're a good one. Nice meeting you. Hi, what's your name?
Susie.
Hi, Susie.
Maze.
Are you gonna cry?
I know. Anyway.
He's dead, get over it. I tell you what though, if you didn't cry when Hughes died, you cried at the funeral, right?
No.
His daughter is like, oh, when will Daddy wake up? He's got work to do. Where's my shovel, Daddy? And he comes out as a zombie, or he comes out as a zombie, he's like, her hand and starts chewing. Do you remember that?
No, I don't.
That's my favorite scene. The new soccer has like eats his like eats her head off and goes, ah, isn't she cute?
I
don't remember that at all. I'm sorry. I didn't mean to ruin it for you. What? You'll see it. It's good. It's good scene.
What
do I have a question for you?
So I have a question more that's like theater related.
Hit me, Susie.
Have you ever worked with someone have you ever had someone hard to work with? And what advice would you give to someone if they had to work so hard to work?
Yeah, I think so. I've directed some shows where some guys are new or whatever. And really, that's up to the director. You've got to have patience and you got to be able to get them there. You know, like the worst thing I think a director can do is give a line read. You know what that is?
Yeah.
It's basically, this is the way I would do your line if I were you. And occasionally you have to because you're on a deadline and sometimes they're just not getting it. But really, every time I do that, I feel like I fail. So what I try to do is explain it to them, get the scene and give them some kind of motivation for that line. Sometimes I'll give them like a one word adverb that's a motivation, like, kill. I want you to kill him, you say.
Yeah.
You know, I want you to hold him, you say. Whatever. And that usually gets them there. If they can't get there, they just don't get cast in there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Right.
And then, I guess, can you say your favorite Hughes line?
Ooh!
Well, my favorite, I've already said my favorite Hughes line, which is, don't fall on Danny! My second favorite, get yourself a wife. Okay, we have 7 minutes. If somebody has something, does somebody have a marker that they want to sign?
Yes.
Yeah. If you bring it up here now, anybody wants something signed, get in line over here, I guess, in the formal line in front of the table. The rest of you, thank you so much for coming to my panel. Just to give these real quick.